for a little bit, and you can tell us about how you're feeling, what you're going through, what your process is.
Well, I'm mostly worried right now about my friends in China. Because of the coronavirus, I get a lot of messages and contacts with friends. I just got a video sent by a very good friend of mine from her apartment. And this is in the night. You see only dark buildings and everybody's standing on the balcony screaming because already for 2 weeks they're just locked in their apartments. So to get rid of their tensions, they basically shout half of the night to get rid of the tensions. Because they're basically in lockup. And that's not even in Wuhan, that's like 800 kilometers from Wuhan. I know from people in Shanghai and Beijing, France, that they locked themselves voluntarily up to help the process of combating the coronavirus. And I've been in communication with a lot of different people from hospitals and clinics and factories and stuff like this, who are busy with medication, making medication, about how the different approaches are from natural medicine perspective. On dealing with this virus, so I've been trying to figure out what they see as a possibility. So I'm now making a video for my channel about this virus, which is hopefully coming out on Saturday. So that's basically on my mind. What people can do at home by using moxa sticks or using herbs or something like this, or exercise to prevent that they get it, because it is a virus which basically can get everybody healthy or not healthy, doesn't really matter. So that's on my mind. That's my process. Story is that it started in Wuhan. We already know from some research that it started actually somewhere outside of Wuhan, and that probably somebody already got sick and took it to the market in Wuhan, even though a lot of research still seems to point to the Wuhan food market. It might not be. The symptoms of the coronavirus look a lot like a regular flu. And flu, of course, is a disastrous disease. It's an epidemic. And I like to point out to my video on epidemics to understand a little bit more about the nature of these kind of diseases and how they relate to other kind of diseases also. When we talk about corona, flu, it starts usually a little bit like a normal common cold. The problem is, though, it relatively quickly transforms into something more serious and can lead to pneumonia. If it doesn't get properly treated, there is a risk of death, a little bit higher than normally when you have pneumonia. This is what coronavirus also does to you. It takes away the qi. This is a serious thing, and I do realize here in Europe, the people that I spoke with in different countries and in the Netherlands, they do not seem to be aware of how serious this could be once it becomes a pandemic. And it means that it is a disease that is scorching the earth. The estimations are that in worst case scenario, something between 65 to 80 million people can die from the disease. And if the Chinese government at this moment and other governments where smaller outbreaks are do well, it might be limited to a few thousand deaths, which is still terrible. But if you realize that in the United States, this moment, more general flu kind of disease already cost this last season 4,000 people their lives. And in Europe, something like 60 people died from the same flu. We didn't hear very much about it, right? But it's a slow transporting flu, so it is relatively contained. It doesn't grow very fast and so on and so on. The problem with this disease is that it is incubating for a period of about 10 days, and then it has slight, not very troubling symptoms before it actually really starts hitting you in your face. Then once you are infected, you immediately become infectious to other people, sort of immediately at least. And that means that everybody you come across might get infected. I don't know exactly, nobody really knows exactly how high is the rate of getting infected. we know that old people, young people, healthy people, unhealthy people, they all run sort of the same risk. Of course, when you're weak, you will probably surrender to it more quickly, but even healthy people, young people have been dying from this coronavirus. It is spreading very rapidly, relatively, even though the most of the victims are at this moment still in Wuhan. It is spreading pretty fast, and also because it is a virus, and a virus is basically a sort of RNA string, or maybe a bit of DNA or something like this, that is finding its way inside your cells, and this is where it does its damage. It changes the cell structure and the functionality of the machinery of your cells. And in that sense, a coronavirus as a crown virus is of course a little bit different than a retrovirus like HIV, and there's all kind of other viruses that also all affect us. And we have a lot of junk genes in our body, and these are all, well, many of them, they are leftovers from genes that have visited us in the past. And in a way, we can say that our mitochondria have a similar kind of origin, in the sense that they moved into our bodies in a long time past, and as a result of that, now are our power cells. So not all viruses are bad. Some viruses actually are very helpful, and some things that are bigger than viruses also very helpful. Just take into account, for instance, the bacteria in your gut. They provide you with half the intelligence in your brain. To me, the irony is a little bit that it all takes place in Wuhan, because I have a little bit of a history of with Wuhan. When my Sifu was thrown out of his monastery by the governor of Xi'an, Wudangshan area, because he wanted to use the premises of our school, our monastery, for his own hotel, because the feng shui of the place apparently was very good. It was actually a good feng shui place, because it was a river coming from the backside, small one, just providing enough income for the monastery to survive. And he wanted to make that bigger and build a big hotel on it, so that there would always be a form of income. And China having problems with these kind of corruptions at times, people are protected by higher up officials, these kind of things happen. And the monastery was demolished one day when I came there, and my sister and my brothers and all the junior students and the senior practitioners and monks, they were all, well, actually I passed by the place and I was like, no, I think I walked too far. And then I look back and I see that the whole hill that was next to the monastery was gone. So I went back and tried to find my community. I went back into the community and I accepted the fact that our monk community is now more like a lifestyle thing. A lifestyle thing that means that there was no real monastery, and different teachers, including myself, we started building all kind of communities, and you are now my community, of course. Well, you are a member of my patron, of course, that is. Whether you're a monk or not, it doesn't really matter. That is part of my community. We moved at a certain point to Wuhan, where we were offered a place, and I learned a lot from this period, and I met a lot of people, industrial people, government people, police people, everybody from Wuhan area came to that place to meet with Sifu, and I shake hands with them. My photos, my movies from that time, they're all on a disc that crashed. So in case you are very handy, I have the disc, you can help it, you can repair it if you want. I spent a lot of time walking around, spending time in the Taoist monastery and the Taoist temple in the center of Wuchang, and also in Hangzhou there were several places where I used to go, and the food market they talk about actually is in Hangzhou, and I used to play in the Hangzhou Boulevard close to the French concession. And this place was in a French concession, and this food market, I've been there many times, I've been there in restaurants in this area, and never had any worry about this place, even though the press says it's terrible because of all these things. Yes, these things happen there, but yeah, viruses can happen anywhere, they can happen in your own toilet. So I wouldn't worry too much about what happened there in the food market. there's places where there is terrible hygiene, where people are healthier because of the terrible hygiene than hospitals. Hospitals are usually way more dangerous to get infectious diseases, as everybody knows nowadays. In relationship to the virus, there are a few things that you have to take into account at the moment when you come across it. This is, I think, the most important part. And after this part, we are going to continue with more practical things to talk about, although this is already pretty much practical. First of all, you have to know that it's a virus, so that's a very important part. You have to take care of your hygiene, and in the warnings that everybody gives, you have to say you have to wash your hands, you have to avoid facial contact, that they don't spit in your face or something like this, similar like with Ebola, where what also still is not completely under control in Africa, and which is still a danger for a pandemic also at the same time. So we have a lot of these kind of troubles in the world right now. And we have to be aware of these kind of things, because they can just all of a sudden be on your doorstep, like malaria when the world is warming up in the Netherlands, where I'm living, where usually is a very mild temperature. The temperature goes up 2 degrees and we have malaria, possibly. Yes, that can happen. Your hygiene is very important. You shouldn't only wash and disinfect your hands. Disinfection in itself is actually very relative, but wash your hands with hot water, because the virus, apparently, according to my friend Tian Lifang, and what she gathered for me as news, is that the virus doesn't really like hot heat. So they're hoping that when the summer comes, the virus actually loosens power in that area anyway, if it doesn't go north too much, where it can spread through Russia and into Europe. So that's very important, and when you are washing your hands, also at the same time wash your face. Make sure you wash it with warm water every time when you've gone out, when you met strangers, and so on and so on. So make sure like that. There's all kind of tissues I have here. This actually is for my lenses for my camera, but there's all kind of tissues to clean yourself with. I don't believe in these things, but if you believe in them and you think they can disinfect you, then be my guest. Don't be surprised if your skin flora and fauna is being destroyed and you eventually end up with having eczema or other worse things. And the chemicals that are in there, they're also very bad. If you get them in your eyes, you have to rinse them with a lot of water. Make sure you wear masks. Masks are very important, so that the masks cover your face would be best. So when you wear a mask, there's a different kind of mask, and I will show you a piece of the video on top of this one to show you what kind of masks there are and how good or how not good they are. Because when there's openings, the virus can go in there, very small. When your mask is too thin, it has only 2 layers, then at that moment, or 3 layers, actually, the virus can pass. 3 layers more difficult than 2 layers, but for instance, the ones that I use for my clinic, they have only 2 layers. I cannot use them to protect myself or my family, and also they are a little bit open and they don't breathe very comfortably, so that you have to leave your nose open to actually get air. And there's a lot of masks that have similar kind of problems. You need at least 4 layers to be sort of protected, and it is called, well, you see it here. And the best, of course, is the mask that I bought especially for my own family. Also for other cases that we might eventually need it, maybe. And these are masks that are guaranteed safe. Filters work for 6 months, or unless when you start smelling strange things through it. And these fit around your skin and your nose so that it's really isolated, and you really have to breathe through the filter, of course. You have to develop the lung habit to do that. And of course, breathing through a mask always brings your air up more in the top part of your lungs, so that eventually, of course, it weakens the chi of your body also. So wearing a mask outside, fine. Inside, no. So inside, shouldn't wear it. You shouldn't wear it all the time. Then there's a dress code. You have to make sure you always have gloves if possible. Latex gloves is okay. Can't go through latex gloves. But make sure your sleeves are closed so that it doesn't go inside. Otherwise, you have to wash yourself completely. What you can do with elastics, you can carry elastics around your wrists and around your ankles, or you can wear your trousers inside your socks. So normally wear 3-4 layers of clothing so that you absolutely are safe, very important. And I don't want to scare you, it's just that you better be safe than sorry, because once you have it, you run a bigger risk. So every time when you can take a precaution to prevent that you run a bigger risk, is of course always better. And it's in your daily life anyway, it's always better to have 2-3 layers dress code and not wear short shirt, short sleeve shirt, or just a shirt, because you're very vulnerable to anything that happens in your environment anytime. And that kind of things in this modern world full of chemicals and poisons and so on, with everything basically smelling bad, is maybe not such a good idea. The rest of the video is for those who have a little bit of knowledge of Chinese medicine and one way or the other are involved in alternative medicine or natural medicine, and they can help offer services to people who need it, preferably of course for free. So I will explain a little bit about what we know at this moment from the coronavirus and how to treat these things. And my first information was actually from my sister Chen Li Fang, and I started researching what she said, and I have a Tibetan student, and she sent me a link about a hospital in China which is called the Renmin Hospital in Kaifeng. The articles about it are not very well read except by professionals. And they made a claim, and they made some theoretical references to solutions that they had in treating people. They didn't treat a lot of people because Kaifeng was not a place with many, many diseases. But now Xi Jinping also last night, he made a remark on a TV speech, I think on a TV speech, that doctors should try to combine Western medicine and Chinese medicine to make sure that the chances of improvement are as large as possible, because of course for China as a whole it is a disaster, and it sees itself as a morally obliged country to make sure that it stays within its own borders. So that means that once China is really suffering from it, and the stock market are already falling, jobs are not working right now, and companies that depend on products from China already started noticing. I know my wife in her food shop, a lot of ingredients, they are on the way, but you know, they already know that a lot of things are already cancelled, so they're not going to come in say a month. And I know from news from Hyundai in Korea, they closed down most of their things, and in a few days time they expect to close down their whole production line, because they are dependent on parts, car parts that are made in China, they're not made in Hyundai. And in that sense, as a country, to be self-sufficient, of course, just like as a person, to be self-sufficient is great, but is in this time not anymore possible. But it also means that industrially and in the way of producing goods that we really need in our daily life, we should set up a political system and an economic system where production is spread out as much as possible, and wealth also is spread out as much as possible, and make sure that there is always going to be a place where you can get materials from, so that, you know, everybody can keep on benefiting from these kind of things. Let me first start with my own analysis on the basis of acupuncture and whatever I made up from all the different kind of things that I had from talking with Chao Yang and Dongfang Zhongyi Dashui in Beijing, from articles from the Chinese medicine authority in the government. They have their own app and website, and they produce free materials to study from, and also from friends in different kind of areas. I will talk to you about Moxa later. I talk to you about herbs. I talk about what Kaifeng Hospital said, and some other things that I picked up here and there that will come pass by. In general, the virus is a cold-producing virus, or is cold by itself. So that means that it produces a mild cold, well, like I said before, and then gradually it turns into more worse and worse situations. And based on the CT scan, we'll only discuss here the herbal situation for when CT scan doesn't show much yet or nothing in your lungs, because this is the moment where you actually can do the most. And for more other things, I will have to make another video more specialized, because that takes a lot more effort, and I'm going to work on that after I finish this one. So I think in a running course of next week I probably have that ready, and you can apply for that. I use it anyway as an example for the Chinese medicine course that I give, so all my members, they can watch it anyway. The first channel that is being affected by this course, by this virus, is the Shaoyang channel. And the Shaoyang channel relates between the heart and the kidneys, and as a result, the Shaoyang channel is regulates the water metabolism between the heart and the kidneys, and the warmth and the cold of your body, and the regulation of the yin and the yang, the jing, the rhythm of your blood flow, and so on and so on. So what it does is it dries up the, no, it cools down and dampens the water from the kidneys, and as a result of that, the heart becomes a little bit more warm, the blood becomes a little bit more dry, and you get a cold dampness residue all over in your body, and that one goes actually downward and causes diarrhea in your defecation. And at that moment, you don't notice very much other symptoms than, well, what can I say, low fever, cough, running nose, just average wind cold symptoms. At the moment when they reach the Taiyang channel, of course, becomes more serious. What you see is that you get signs from a Yang Xu condition. So the Yang is being diminished at that moment. It's being exhausted, basically. And as a result of that, there will be cold. So the cold is not coming from the virus itself, but the virus causes the Yang to become Xu conditioned, so it becomes decrepit. And as a result of the decrepacy of the Yang Qi, the body becomes cold. This is just a standard thing that happens to everybody who has that, and the coldness actually creates dampness. So cold dampness, that is why. And the Yang Xu is then, of course, the foundation of the dampness. As a result of that, you get stagnations of water in the body, and this is mostly in the chest area. So that you get around the lungs, you get in the pleura, you get congestions. I will show you later with Moxa. I'll explain you later with Moxa how to solve that. And there are several things that you can do. At the moment when it's still in the Shaoyin, and you can solve the Yang Xu with doing exercise, because the exercise can help you, if your body is strong enough anyway, to create Yang Qi. That is, of course, Dantian meditation, Chan Zhuang in the wide stance, not in a narrow stance, because that's too much, that's too soft, too gentle, basically. And a little bit strong Tai Chi Chuan practice. Just regular Kung Fu is not suitable because it is too heating, it creates too much fire. And also Shaolin practice creates sometimes too much heat to create the right kind of strength in your practice. So Tai Chi Kung Fu actually is sufficient, but it has to be done with a little bit of excessive input. But for this, you should have practiced already before. If you haven't, then probably your Tai Chi Chuan will not be sufficient, because it has to create the Yang Qi that keeps the wind and the cold outside of your body. Then, of course, the cold can be resolved by Moxa. I will talk about it later. And also the dampness has to be resolved by movement. That is, period. You see it with people who are depressed. They will tend to move less. That's the dampness factor in the depression at that moment. They have a dampness depression. And as a result of that, they don't feel motivated to move. And they don't feel motivated to get off their sofa or out of their bed or anything like that. Then, of course, when you are sick, you feel like, and you don't feel like motivated to move. So that's an important part. The acupuncture, then, in that sense, is mostly focused on the Taiyang and on the Shaoyin channel. And this is the main treatment method with acupuncture. I had a long talk with a good friend of mine from Jiangxi. She works in a Moxa hospital. We had a long talk about how they deal with these kind of things. If you want Moxa, you don't have Moxa, I can order it for you, no problem. You just contact me and I'll make sure you get some. The prices are, of course, dependent a little bit on where you are. The main technique that they have experimented with so far is one of dredging the channels. And when they dredge the channels, they choose to treat mostly the kidney and the bladder channels, and of course the kidneys itself on the back. Of course, this is the Yang Qi, remember? We talked about it before. And then also the heart arm channel, the hand arm channel, they treat, and the lung channel in the same way also. And in the legs, they treat the P channel, the spleen pancreas, and also the kidney channel. So you see that the heart channel, kidney channel, they're all also treated just like how I discussed this before. The dredging is a technique where you go up and down with the moxa gradually to make sure that the channel flow is being pushed forward and backwards, and that the cold is being taken out, and that the dampness is being well, you can create, actually, you have possibility also is to create dampness with moxa, and as always, what you have to be careful. then she said, like, it's good to use a dragon bone moxa, which is like where you put on ginger slices, so that you burn the ginger and the moxa together inside the body. That is actually quite a lot of burning, and you have to have good ventilation. If you also do it on the back and on the waist and on the legs at the same time, and then especially on the Sanjiao channel. The front also, you do moxa on the chest for the stagnated waters in the chest, and also the lymph in the armpits and in the neck, so that they become warm. And of course in the abdominal groove on the belly, to make sure that the abdominal groove is where you also put the moxa. And then in that way you can warm this place also. The Kaifeng Hospital, they were pretty precise in which formulas they used, and they referred specifically to Zhang Zhongjing, a very famous Chinese medicine doctor who wrote a text about worm diseases, and I've always been a very big fan of worm diseases, that most of diseases are caused by warmth. And this is also one of the reasons why in our program we emphasize all the time on keeping ourselves cool, while our society actually tries to get people as hot as possible, because hot people are excitable and excited and are easy to buy things. Because they can't control their emotions and their feelings, so they're easily manipulated by politicians and marketing people. When we look at these herbal concoctions that I come up with, they classify them in basically five different levels. And the first level and the second level I will discuss with you extensively, and third and the fourth and the fifth level I will mention basically only. When they are in the first level, we see that the CT scan, then at that moment they say anyway that the CT scan then doesn't show any shadows, so that is then itself is positive. But there's a low fever, and there's cough, there's a running nose, there's wind cold at the Taiyang channel, and this is something that can be addressed actually with Gurgen decoction. And the Gurgen decoction attacks the pathogenic heat, which is shifting through the lungs, and it's shifting from the lungs to the large intestine, which interiorizes that way. So, well, what you see with common cold is that when it's not properly treated, it goes to the interior, and goes usually from the skin or from the neck or the forehead or something like this. It goes into the lungs, and then from the lungs into the intestines, from the intestines into the kidneys, and from the kidneys into the body, as one of the trajectories that it can take. At the moment when it comes on the interior, it increases the body heat. That's what we call fever. And at the moment when the body heat is being increased, that means that it basically is growing, the virus is growing. Like little children, when they grow, they produce heat. And at the moment when they produce heat, then at that moment they grow, they become bigger. I have two kids, I can see that happen every day. And I can see how they have these hot spells preceding their growth spurts. This is for a virus, it's no different than from any other animal. Of course, this warmth goes together with the diarrhea, dampness, and the dampness is hot, and it causes a scorching feeling on your anus. Not a very pleasant sensation. If you ever had that, your stool might be yellowish in color. That is not very nice color, of course, to see. And you might have a stiff and a rigid neck, like you have a stiff neck. People have that with cold general. The Kogan decoction is based on the treatment of cold, and it has Kogan, of course, inside. That's Pueraria, and also honey-fried licorice, Scutellia, and also Coptis root herbs. And these are the four main ingredients. There's different variations of this formula with more herbs. If you read Bensky, there will be three or four more herbs in there. But a good formula needs only three or four herbs, so it's enough usually. All the other things are embellishments usually. When we go to the second level, when it becomes a little bit more serious, then the fever becomes higher and reaches over 38 degrees. The CT scan still doesn't show any damage, so you don't have to worry about the lung being affected. That's only on the other levels. But at that moment, we use Shogun Mahuang decoction, and Shogun Mahuang decoction also is discussed in Bensky, and also being discussed in the Warm Disease text from Zhang Zhongjing. And in this case, the warming of the lung becomes, of course, larger, and the cold congests the fluids in the chest. This is where it becomes really very serious. And as a result of that, you get a rebellious qi from the lungs, and can also be a rebellious qi from the stomach at that time. So sometimes people have vomiting also, but definitely have a strong cough. They have wheezing in the lungs, and sometimes even rattling, like while breathing. Also, the Shogun Mahuang decoction is used usually with the Qinglong decoction. I'm sorry, and the basic ingredient from the Shogun Mahuang is Abelacando and Ephedra. It's also called Abelacandra and Ephedra decoction. What I'm going to do myself, I'm going to make standard formulas and make them ready by that time. That I think, like, now it's going to be like that, and I'm going to look also for things that can be used as an alternative for these ingredients, just things that grow in your own environment. There's a lot of things you can just buy as a plant in your plant shop, so why not? Then, when there's abnormal shadows in the lungs, then at that moment it becomes a little bit more serious, of course, because then at that moment you really have a lung infection. That's the turning point. You start getting in a pneumonia. If it would be acupuncture, there's a particular technique for which you first have to learn proper qigong, and you shouldn't work with energy then, but you should really do learn qigong. And then at that moment, you can take the heat on the backside out through the back shoe points, where normally the back shoe points are entry points to bring things in. So you need to do a reversal at that moment to take the heat out, and then after 3 or 4 days, the effect should become visible, and that the infection should be corrected. But in the case of you don't know how to do that, then you can take a Zheqi decoction. Just look it up. And Bengqi has the Zheqi decoction, and also you can combine it with the Fuling Xini decoction, also found in Bensky. If you don't have that available, you can also combine Shogun Mahuang decoction, like we mentioned before, in combination with the Qianjin Wei Zi decoction, and that is another one that you can also find in Bensky. I feel like I'm making an advertisement for Bensky. Bensky? Bensky, you can make some advertisement for me too. The fourth level, when it becomes even more serious, you can also use Weishen decoction and Zheqi decoction together. It was said by the Kaifeng Hospital that they had two people who lowered the fever until 36.5 degrees and cleared the lungs with this decoction. So they didn't advise it as a primary decoction, but they said they had two people who they cleared with that. Then, as a last one, they considered that Jingfang decoction for treating epidemic disease and serious diseases is a good way to deal with this. And this is like more like a general decoction, and as a result of that, you can use it for basically every epidemic, they say. So that is always good to have as a reserve with you. And if I have time, when I make this video, I will put here the recipe for that one. Always helpful to be able to have something like this. I hope this was very good to you. I made a lot of recordings altogether, and I hope that all these kind of things, they will be helpful for you to prevent getting it once it becomes a pandemic. Now it is just an epidemic in China and some other countries, although in Japan there's already some cases of people who got infected in Thailand. So Thailand probably it's already pretty much rampant, and we don't hear so much about it in the press, but that's already happened. And also in Korea they had some cases coming from other countries, also from Thailand and also from Japan, that became sick in these countries. In other countries like Mongolia, Russia, they have already closed the borders. There are some countries which are client states from China, like Burma and Laos and so on. These client states, they all have a lot of Chinese in there, and the borders are relatively open with China. But I understand they now are also closing the borders, and as a result of that, maybe they can prevent it gets into their area. There are still areas in China where it's not so much. My wife comes from Tumen in Jilin, and there also have some cases already, and that is like 4,000, 3,000 kilometers away from Wuhan. So you can see that because of the spread of the people with the Spring Festival, people go far through China, they travel far, and that means that the risk becomes larger and larger. As long as it stayed in the mountains where people were hunting for these ingredients that they're going to sell in the market, and they got infected, it only stayed local, and then it didn't spread very much. But it's just because we are used to living in large communities of millions, and Wuhan is a city of 11 million people, 12 million people, and has another city of 9 million people, Hong Kong, next to it. And then close by is Xiangfang, with also something like 10 million. And Xiangfang actually is smaller, I think it's like something like 6 million. And then a little bit further is Xi'an with 11 million, similar size like Shenzhen, same age of city. So these kind of places, everything spreads really very fast. It's very difficult to control. And as you saw in the beginning of the video, it's of course, for every person, it's a personal tragedy to be involved in such a thing. And let's just pray and hope that it doesn't get out of China, not too far away anyway, and that it doesn't have to bother any other countries more than as a fake scare. But make sure that if it happens, that you are well prepared. Bless you.
大董见闻神臭 动员神灵大动地震广化电池民谣三境流火万里全年无闻原始有翅贵物道心闻贵机杼色送风影寂寂扭绿林